Yeah, this is the event we have over the .conf organization. I'm not sure what's going to happen here. Nobody is, but Kanaf wants to say something.
It's your problem now.
Okay,
Neil, you still have some money to work with.
Okay. The basic idea behind this thing was that DC7 team lists some mistakes, errors that have been made, or things that could be improved, or also things that did work very good. So the Argentinian team doesn't make the same mistakes like we did, and probably gets a better DEPCOF or something.
The lesson learning wiki page is in the wiki.depcof.org.
What?
The last learning page.
Wait, we're recording this or not? Because if we are, let's stick to the microphone. If we're not, then let's throw the microphone.
No,
okay.
Okay.
I don't think we follow.
Okay, so
maybe you put the record so
let's
that
we have it.
Yeah,
I know. Bring down, write down everything.
I'm happy to read this over to you.
There is no lesson learning.
Just write it in the file. Then we'll put it in the wiki.
Start the wiki page, not
because the wiki, I write the file.
Which wiki?
We use the DEFCON wiki.
Wiki.DEFCON for
DEFCON
7?
Yeah. Wiki.DEFCON.
DEFCON 7 is
One thing the video team noted was that there was not much talk in speaker management. Also, some speakers complained to me that they came here and didn't know what they were supposed to do. There were no introductions to the speakers. Taking care that the talk ends was also done by the video team partly, but the video team has to concentrate on video and not managing the talks. That should be improved next year.
Is there a reason why we had four talks at the same time? I think that was kind of bad for the video team and also bad for talk management. I think it would have been better to have less places.
Less.
I think you have a good point there. We need the four places because they were full most of the time. There is activity for all the places, but the video team maybe should concentrate only on taping the official talks and leaving the buffs as on safe. Because even though we tape them, the quality of what you can get in the buff rooms is way below what you get at the talk rooms. You get the all the time. And
We have plans to increase the audio setup for the both rooms as well.
Token for this for who should speak.
Shut
so,
up.
Yeah,
something
like this.
But you know, before going, say whatever you have to say before going.
No, and more
what the session is meant to be for, because that's it. It's just lots of little details. I'm not sure we need, well, like the video team stuff and so on. And
I said in the beginning, the session is for giving over from DEPCOM 7 to the DEPCOM 8, the handover, and listing things that could be improved in the future. So if you have something to list, feel free.
The DEPCOM 7 team are going to do a retrospective in July, so we're going to get the report out and have some ideas about what we could have done better in quite a quick time frame. But I mean, we're still actually doing the conference at the moment, and it's I certainly could say a lot about how we could do accommodation better, but it's a bit, it might all go wrong tonight again anyway, then I'd have more to say tomorrow, so.
But
Steve
John.
I want I think if we have four talk rooms, people will always get bops in there or whatnot. And what we want for the video team for Pentagraph next year is that we can have a flag for each event and say, this will not be videotaped, which can be either requested by the person giving the bop or by the video team who will say, we will not videotape the whiskey bop, so it doesn't show up in our thing. And also this movie will always happen.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Chairman.
Thank you. Chairman, come on. What I wanted to say, perhaps it is enough to just do audio recording for the bobs, if it is possible to make them, give them some luck. I don't know. This is one remark. And the other remark is for the talks, I don't know really if there is a need for introducing the speaker. He can probably do it himself with three sentences. And the video team to show up this 10 minutes left or so, they can read it on their tape if it's finished, or it is about to finish, they can do it perhaps. So we can save some people, organize a talk. So I don't know. So I don't think it was really bad this year in this aspect.
I like the other recording. Is this possible?
As an addition, whatever.
Okay. No. I want to know if it is possible.
Everything is possible, but is it desirable? Well, okay. Reply to you. Yes, of course, we don't have to have somebody to introduce the speaker. But on the other side, it is nice to introduce somebody, and it is important to let the people in the video team focus on video team. And for example, we always have to get a volunteer from the audience to run around with the microphone. And the video team have to keep an eye on the 5-minute signs. So we need a person responsible for the room, regardless if there's taping or not. I want to go back to something that I was going to say. If Morey plans on leaving, as he always does, in the middle of the session, I think it's important for us to know, even if we're still in the middle of everything and we don't have the final words on anything, who plans on staying in the team, who says, okay, that's it, I don't count them in next year, whatever. So I'd like to see who stays in. Okay, we're optimistic. Good.
How about having chairs for some talks? Like, for example, three talks would be with one chair, and then he could also, or she could also take care of the timing, how the talk
is. Yes, but that's losing in asking the details. It's okay,
When I raised this point, it was about do we need four places for talks at the same time? All the rest is just details that we can work out. But my question is, for next year, do we need four spaces, or are two, like in Helsinki or like in Mexico, are two places enough, or do we need four? That's my question, maybe.
Two for talks and two for both.
Yeah. The thing is, both were not supposed to be talks.
Mm.
Yeah.
Two for talks and two for both. Two rooms.
This year, certainly, when we set up things, I wasn't actually expecting us to have four sessions scheduled against each other the whole time. We wanted those rooms available, but I expected the both rooms to be used a lot more just as extra catalog space and so on than they actually were. I didn't realise so many, in the number of talks as well. Personally, I'm kind of in favour of fewer good talks rather than just filling up every day entirely with talks. So on a personal level, I was not expecting so many events against each other in that way, but it's just, there's always an argument of, if people want to give talks, should you just let them do it? Or do you say, no, you can't, but you can't really stop them, et cetera?
I think you can't stop them. Because if we have the bathrooms, they will say, oh great, there are now five people doing Debbie and Matt here, let's just have a bath. And then they will set it in Penta and it's just there. I think maybe three rooms might be enough if there are less people in Argentina, depending on how many people register for the next conference. But I also don't think it's a real problem to have four talks going on. If people prefer to have a boss to work together and don't go to the talk, fine.
Yeah, the thing is, a boss is a very important figure. I mean, the kind of work that you do during a talk is completely different from what you do during a boss. And I would favor having at least two spaces, I mean, the same amount of spaces for one kind of work than for the other, but not committing to tape everything or give the same infrastructure to everything. Maybe not even schedule it so strictly.
The thing is that many people can't come to DevCon, and many of those people work in groups, and they use the string to be on the bus, which are usually decision-making reunions and stuff like that. So I think bots are really important, and they should be at least streamed, if not maybe taped or edited or whatever. So
I would like to agree with Gunnar that the bots are not so formal, and if the people who are in the bot not manage to inform the other who can't attend without the video, then something is even wrong. So I think talks will be fine for recording, but the bots should be, there should be two parallel rules, but not recording. If that was...
Next point, please.
Just regarding the bots.
No. Shall I go over some problems we've had this year? Okay. I think one of the big problems we've had this year, it's difficult with the amount of volunteers we've had. We've had a really sort of short numbers, so the amount of work we're trying to do. Sorry, can people, am I speaking too fast?
Can you speak again?
Sorry. We have very low numbers of people, volunteers and organisation teams. Communications are quite difficult with what we've had. Certainly over the last couple of days, we've not had much track of who's here, who's doing what, who's in charge of someone.
How many people should be?
The main point is you really need someone. You need someone to be in charge purely of keeping track of what's going on, and that person really has to be dedicated to that. Over DevConf, I mean, that's a big commitment, because if DevConf goes for 2 weeks, you're also going to have a week beforehand where there's a lot of activity going on, there's a lot of things arriving, you need equipment set up. So you've a week before DevCon, you've got DevCamp, got DevCon, and they're probably going to be shattered for another week afterwards and have to sleep. So that's like someone taking a month out of their life to dedicate to DevCon, and you really need someone that's actually able to do that. You're going to need a lot of resource from certain core, you know, a lot of dedication from some core members. I'm sorry, too fast. So certainly communications, it was difficult this year. If we had things like better radios, that might have helped a lot. We had some radios here that weren't working correctly. So they weren't working correctly. So we've not been using the radios. So if everyone on the team, everyone, and if you had the details of this person is in charge of so-and-so, this person's in charge of this, this person's in charge of that, and you've all got radios, you can communicate a lot more effectively. Communications were poor this year, and it makes things quite difficult. And you can see we're all sitting here in this booth. If you're holding sessions and they're structured, it takes a lot of time of people, and people have to dedicate a lot of time. And I've noticed also in the Orga team meetings, we can sit there for 2 hours with an Orga team meeting and not get through very much, and that's 2 hours for maybe 10 people. That's a lot of time again taken. So you really need to streamline the communications. That's quite important for next year.
I understand two things. We need more volunteers, and we need radios
Radios, but also better structure. Really clear structure of who's doing what, and you need someone to, you need someone managing that structure. Whoever's actually who can dedicate the whole time through has to keep track of that. Because I think we needed a bit more of that.
Maybe Marcela,
can you comment on the work you did with volunteers last year? No, but because you were in charge of that, and you did it. You did.
There were nearly no local team.
And
I managed with people that volunteered from everywhere. That's what I did.
Okay. I didn't want to throw a hot potato on you. No, the thing is, last year, Marcela was the volunteer coordinator. We did have it, but, well, as she says, even having a coordinator may not be enough. We may need to think how to enforce that structure, because I have rethought all over what happened then. In the end, we had a lot of local volunteers, and we had, yes,
volunteers that were there during the days of the conference, not before. We didn't have people planning, we didn't have people load balancing before, but during the conference we had 20, 30 Mexicans who had no relation with the project, and many people from inside. So, well, the thing is, we had a coordinator, but we didn't have a structure for that. So maybe it's not abandoning the coordinator, but creating something around it.
I think what well this year was that we had mostly daily meetings of the OGA team, which can keep the structure intact and have them really the whole week of DepCamp and DepConf. Make them short, but make them. That really, really helped.
Go back to your point about local volunteers. Volunteering this year, we've not had that much help from some of the delegates. We could have had more responsiveness from them. But at the same time, if you've got help from people who are at the conference, these are people who have suddenly appeared. You don't know who they are. You've not built up a relationship with a team with them. And you don't have much control over what they're doing. So that as useful as they are as a resource, you can only get so much out of them. If you had radios, and maybe if you could give those people radios and can keep track of what they were doing and what time they can dedicate, maybe you can get more out of them and actually have them doing more useful. We did have people who helped out and did a lot of work with networking and so on, but to get the maximum amount of use out of that and to help to know more about what people are doing.
Why radios, you know, on IRC channel?
Sorry?
Because you're not an IRC.
People cannot communicate with IRC running around the building. If you're trying to cable things up and you want to know if someone's...
You are running now. Sorry, speak slowly.
Sorry. If you are running around the building and there's a problem upstairs and you need to get hold of this person very quickly, if you send them a message in IRC, they're not going to read that for 10 minutes or 15 minutes. And the problem is immediate. You're going to have to run till you find them. If you've got a radio and you put it out on the radio, it's instant. You're going to get someone there and then. You know where they are, and you can find them. And as long as people are that accessible, it makes such a difference. That was a big problem this year.
As a side note, on the subject of IRC, I think we had quite a lot of problems relying on that for team meetings in the months prior to actually coming together. Obviously, there's the issue of everyone talking at the same time, but also trying to minute correctly and last logging and things was very difficult, and it's probably not possible for the next year or so, but it would be interesting to see what other methods could be used to handle team meetings in where people all over the world, I don't know, video conferencing, that sort of thing. There might be some opportunity, there might be some better technologies for that.
Again, on the team meetings, it would be nice if there was more structure to the team meetings. You can have a standard format where you decide actions at the team meetings and you note them down clearly what the actions are meant to be doing, who's meant to do them, and next team meeting, review those actions, ensure they've been done since the last team meeting, ensure things are progressing, and try and establish more structure because it'll help things move along a lot faster.
Ubuntu wrote a nice bot for meetings to write the minutes automatically, collect to-do items, and the stuff. It's really simple bot, and it's linked on Wikidata and Alcoy, I believe, but I can give it to you. The other thing, I think really a volunteer manager is more important than having radio mix. Radio mix are microphone, radios are a nice tool to help get keeping in touch, but it should really be one person for the volunteers, and knowing who is volunteering for what, and we need more volunteers for specific tasks. And I'm not sure if that was said in the beginning, but here also was missing somebody who was in charge of these rooms, like in the upper room that the band suddenly came, that was also, this is partly the talk manager's role, but it's a room role, I'm not sure how that goes on.
The audio, for example, is from here, or you should bring it here?
We have
it.
It's mostly hired. It's some stuff from the video team brought, and I've spoken with the DPL to get Debian founds to buy stuff for the video team, and what my proposal to buy is fix audio for us. Because we have cameras which are not so good, which we can get better cameras later, but first have proper audio, because audio is the really important stuff for the talks. Oh. If the video is bad, it's but get better audio setup, which is the same in every room. Then we still need for the big room, still need a PA, but use for the rest, you don't need amplifiers.
The video things are small, but the audio things is bigger. You should bring in plane to Argentina. This is it. And you
the mixers, the
yeah, it's small enough to bring around. I've seen a nice setup at ACA, which really is not expensive and can be carried around.
So for the next year, that's a, we should not.
We are losing our.
Yeah, that's just detail again.
Okay, but. I wanted to ask you about the layout, about the characteristics of the hotel we will be at. I mean, because there's no much point in saying that it's bad for a bathroom to serve also as a connecting aisle, like it was here. I mean, that's losing in details we don't want. How is this hotel prepared for this? I understand it's very well prepared, so we will have much less problems adequating the facilities to our needs.
Yes, it's a hotel that's used to having conferences. It has like 50 conferences a year. It has rooms for 850 people for sleeping.
No.
Rooms for sleeping, and it has seven conference rooms. But most of them are quite big. They are talk rooms. We probably will divide one of the big rooms into separate places to have the both rooms there. Mm-hmm. Not so big, but that's the idea. Both are supposed not to be so big. So we'll have like a talk room where a lot of people can go and the different smaller spaces, something like that.
And they are all in the same floor. Easier to move. Yes. They are always in. They are all in the same room. In the same floor.
Something that would be interesting, maybe for you to try around or somebody else. There are cameras that are specifically made for video conferencing that can be centrally controlled. That can be set on the roof, so you don't have people's heads across. So. I know we cannot buy them because they are very expensive, but we may get a sponsor to lend them to us. Having a centrally controlled room with one video operator instead of four would be of three, it would be very nice. So maybe we should look into that.
But I think it's really video detail. You're in the video team, let's discuss this on the mailing list later.
But you talk about the sponsor.
One thing that happened a couple times in different ways this year was we left one thing or another too late. We had this Sun Machine shipped and it got held up in customs and we didn't get it till the middle of DevConf. We didn't have it at all during DevCamp. A few other things popped up at the last minute because we thought they would be able to be expedited and they wouldn't. So something that might be useful is actually try to get something shipped to you in Argentina a month ahead of time and see how long it really takes. If I had any idea Sun couldn't get a machine into Great Britain, I would have, we might have changed. I don't actually care about details.
No.
If it works fine, that's great, but
no.
I'm just...
If we are going to get things shipped, it should be done like a month in advance.
Yeah.
The very least.
I've had many problems getting stuff.
Yeah, you have to go custom.
It's not just that, it's the general principle of which things to happen.
Sponsorship was another problem that I don't know what you can do about that.
The problem with custom is not a new one. We had the same problem with the T-shirts in Oslo in 2003. And they actually end up costing more than the T-shirts themselves in customs. So just make sure.
That's detail.
T-shirts
can be done in Argentina.
Yeah, that's detail.
Just make sure. This will be a problem in any country. As far as I know, all DevConfs have had this problem
you're shipping it too late, that's up in customs, you have to pay to get them out of there, and it's like, even if it's gifts, it ends up being very expensive. That's another thing I wanted to mention is in Oslo, we were three people in the main organizing team. I was like the coordinator of all of it. And we had a good experience having one person in charge of the front desk. That was like the
what?
Front desk. That was the information coordination center. That they would know what was going on, where people were, and when someone was looked after, but they were told to go to the front desk, people would go to the front desk, ask for people. But of course, that was a smaller venue.
Yes.
But still having one meeting place that knows what's going on, it's a very valuable thing.
Well, we did try to know with the front desk.
We did try to keep on top of things with the front desk. One of the problems was actually keeping enough people informed of everything that was going on. We did start off with quite a few more people involved, and it was just very hard to help them keep track of all of the information that was flowing back and forth.
This is where we have the daily meetings.
Yeah.
But again, there's lots of communications.
There's lots of communications issues around that. We also had problems where if we want to announce to all the delegates, we had problems with Cowgate. To get information to the delegates and information back from the delegates was very difficult. We had to have people running into talks, announcing the talks, posting a list, saying an IRC. Even then, delegates didn't get the information or didn't give us information back. You need to work quite hard on making sure you have enough communication channels that you can actually get the information you want out to the right people. It's very difficult.
Yeah, I'd say we tried various things like posting to announce, but realistically, maybe not everyone's going to have computer access at DevConf, as crazy as that sounds. So paper copies at reception and things like that as well. It would be quite nice, possibly something that could be done with Penta, to be able to do mail-outs to a set of people meeting a certain criteria. Because, well, the closest we've got to that is IRC nicknames at the moment. And that's semi-helpful, but we don't have a lot of email information in Penta. Possibly we should be stricter with registrations to make sure we have this information or people get shouted at a lot earlier.
Well, one point that Luciano raised and that obviously worries us is the sponsor thing. It was like a big problem this year, and we don't want it to be like that next year. So, can we speak about it?
The reason for the problem this year was that we didn't have the sponsor contacts at the beginning of the year because we weren't given them by the people from the previous year.
We have, but now I think Steps will continue doing sponsorship, I hope, and then and other people who have now made it, so that's fine. One lesson I learned in Mexico was that after we had problems getting the hardware, that we would also try to ship stuff to Mexico from HP in the US to Mexico, which was really a problem. But learned then later that it would not have been a problem to get stuff from HP Mexico. So try to get local sponsors in Argentina for hardware stuff so you don't have to go through customs.
We got the things everything for HP in Mexico. We didn't as well, but anyway.
We have HP office.
About the sponsors. Who's going to be in the sponsorship team for next year? The getting money in. The money in team.
One will be Sledge again. I think Morten probably. I have some contacts. Holger has some contacts. Stockholm said he wants to join again and help. So maybe him. Depends on if the rest of the team wants it. And some from you probably if you want.
I would say we need an Argentinian.
Yes, we should have locals.
I was asking about not Argentinian people.
Yes, there could be the non-Argentinian people. Probably some others that had contacts this year too, like Max had some contact with Siemens and he should continue because they already know each other. But that's it, more or less.
I have a more general question. You asked for one moment before who want to stay in the team. How is it possible to join the team? Yeah, well, just do some work. The problem is, I don't like to promise something and find out that I can't fit this promise. I just want kind of a to-do list, what can be done, and then I could see if I can do it.
Join the meetings.
The mailing list.
A very useful role that several people this year did, people like Chris and Noodles and a few others, was show up. They weren't available to do a lot of the pre-planning, but they showed up and then gave us their whole day, or their whole time here. You know, Chris worked at front desk, he took over the wireless, Noodles did a lot of work with accommodation, and frankly, policed the night venue a lot of nights. It was, you know, very useful. So if you want to do something like that, I think more people doing that is great.
Yes, it's the local stuff, and if you want to help during the year, we have mailing lists, the conf team is one, where things are posted, and then we have, I think first every month, a meeting on IRC where we discuss stuff, how it's going on. And if you show up there and just say, I could work on this task, and then report to the mailing list and continue to do that.
Okay, but let's try to finish a point before starting a new one. Back to the sponsor things. Also, there are very different kinds of sponsor needs. I think, because of what I know, that the local sponsors will be not so much, well, if you can get some, that will be the best, but not so much sponsors giving money, but giving facilities. So, but yes, you have to start asking. And a problem we had, well, also regarding what you said, it's the same as for sponsors. Local people will try to work, will try to help you. The thing is, when we started the organization for the one in Mexico, some people approach and say, what do I do? I told them, okay, get to the meetings and see what you can do. But some local people are not involved, so they need to be given tasks. So think of that.
It's very difficult when people ask you, what can I do? Give me a job to do that I'll go into. Many people have asked me, tell me something I can do to help with DevConf. And what you really want is people with initiative who will be there and have a rough area they deal with. So if they're dealing with video or they deal with audio, you don't want someone to say, what do I do? You want someone that comes down and this isn't working, they'll fix it. They'll work out how to fix it without having to be told how. What you said before about the people being available, and they're just dedicating time and being available and dealing with what comes up, that is very helpful. People that want to just do a single task, that's very difficult to schedule. So if you want people to help you and they can do what the Chris and that were doing, that makes a big difference.
Yeah, I would second that, yeah. The best way to get involved at an early stage would be to attend the meetings or read the minutes or minute the meetings, so you get an idea of who's doing what, and you might spot that there are areas which aren't being covered. But yeah, initiative is great. We did have quite a lot of posts on the mailing list in the months running up to DevConf as well. But everybody, we just thought, well, I don't know, come along, what have we missed?
In regard with the volunteers that don't have the initiative to just go and fix the stuff by themselves, I think the volunteer coordinator role that was talking previously will probably work very well in assigning that people stuff, because you'll always have volunteers wondering what to do.
Same back on that. If people don't have much initiative and you give them a job to do, very often it doesn't get done. Very many times I've told people, do this, do that, come back, hasn't happened because they've seen a problem and they've given up on the job rather than trying to work around the problem, they're doing what's needed. And you can give the same job to one person, then to the next person, then to the next person. None of them do it, and then you have a problem. It's difficult. When the people that show initiative, you build up trust with them, and the more you trust that person that's shown repeatedly they have initiative, the the more you can actually rely on them and say, I've told this person to do that job, they do it, and you're happy with trusting for that. The people that don't, you can't give them things that if they don't do it, problems will happen. So relationships are really important, and if you've got new members, local volunteers, that you don't know, you don't have that relationship, you don't have that trust, and you don't know who will do things.
I mean, there is the same issue for the planning period, that it is unfortunately true that what we need is not just people who have a fixed amount of time. We need people that if there's a big problem on something, they can put in more time, because say on some of these areas, we have a big problems, well, for example, on accommodation. John has done a huge amount of great work there, but we kept on just losing people on that because it was a difficult problem, the whole ranging accommodation area. And we get to some point and people just stopped because they found us taking too much time. And of course, I'm not saying that that's bad of them, but what you want someone to do a job who can carry on, because it's much harder than for the next.